Hey, hello everyone. Welcome to our next webinar in our Faceware webinar series. My name is Peter Bush. I'm the Chief Strategy Officer, one of the co-founders here at Faceware. It's my esteemed pleasure to present today a very unique topic that I think is very relevant to our user base. I've been doing this a long time in terms of facial motion capture and seeing how our tools are used in such a wide variety of ways around the world. Kind of gives us a pulse on how content's being created. And in October of last year, a group of very talented individuals came with me with a very new demo I had never seen our tools be used for. And I remember one of my sort of initial reactions was, I think you guys might be onto something here as a really solid framework. And my biggest advice, we were just talking about it here a little bit ago, was don't just create a tech demo, right? And so that's what's kind of unique about what you're about to see is not only everything you're looking at here as a demo will be made available externally this summer. It'll be something you guys can actually get your hands on. And even additionally, you guys can reach out to them today and start a dialogue to be one of their early testers sooner than later. So we're very excited to be presenting this virtual humans demo. And it's a very different take on how our tools are classically used. So we're excited here. So with me today, I have Andrew McDonald. He's the Executive Creative Director at Cream Productions. And Stefan Kozak, he's our principal investigator. And if you guys aren't familiar with the Sheridan College Research Center, specifically CERT, which is on the Pinewood lot, CERT is well positioned to consult with commercial studios like Cream and work on specific projects just like this. And so our goal today is to walk through a workflow on how our tools on the Faceware side of things, Analyzer and Retargeter specifically, and our Mark IV Headcam can be combined to create animated digital humans in a very unique manner. I think you guys are really gonna like what's coming. Again, these tools will be made available externally coming this summer. Please note a couple things before we get rolling here. In the chat, we'll be posting some very helpful links, one of which is where you guys can go and sign up for updates on these tools when they will be made available. You can also be added to their mailing list or reach out directly to the DDH team to start testing these tools. So the sooner you get your inquiry in, the sooner that you can actually start testing this out. They're hungry for feedback, which is always exciting. Last housekeeping items, we are recording this session and it will be made available like all of our other webinars, and we'll continue to provide visibility into this workflow and updates as we go. So you guys aren't here to hear me, and that's why I want to turn it over now to Mr. Andrew McDonald.
My name is Andrew McDonald. I'm Executive Creative Director at Cream Productions. This has been my job for the past 7 years. I've spent the previous 15 to 18 years as a cinematographer, director, cameraman, shooting Discovery, History, Nat Geo, that kind of stuff, traveling around, and working for, as a freelance capacity, the company Cream Productions. Now I work there full time, and I'm sort of heading up the digital department within Cream. And then, Stefan, do you want to introduce yourself?
Sure. Yeah, my name is Stefan Kozak, and I'm from CERT, which Peter introduced as the CERT Screen Industries Research and Training Center. And we're a research center at Sheridan College. And I'm heading up the virtual humans and character animation VFX and CG workflows at the center.
Cool. Yeah. And the story of how this, you know, this all came about and this webinar came about was essentially a television production company opened up a digital division and started exploring what could be done in the world of interactive digital media, beginning with 360 video and then moving into game engine and producing like volumetric interactive content. And what we decided to do, and I would say incredibly naively, was to take the model that we use for a lot of our television shows, which is to take a celebrity host. Like, for example, we have a show called Wild Things where we have Dominic Monaghan, who was one of the hobbits in Lord of the Rings, travel around the world doing a nature show. And to kind of take that model and see if we could put it into a volumetric VR experience, and just as sort of these mobile headsets were coming out like Quest. So naively, we thought, hey, we're going to sell something on celebrity likeness and create that celebrity as a digital character and then make it run in a Quest. And then we went, oh, that's pretty bloody difficult. So just at that moment, we sold some of these ideas and realized, how are we going to execute this, especially without any experience in digital characters? We got in touch with Sheridan College, which is located here in Toronto, and they have these funded programs to bring industry into the university to give practical projects for the students to work on. And that's how we met Stefan. And we came to them with this novel idea of maybe just taking the video of the face and just projecting it onto a mannequin head and seeing where we got to with that. And then from there, Stefan and I developed this long-standing relationship where we sort of evolved this entire process. So basically, this was, you know, innovation born out of necessity, basically, in a nutshell. So to cover all that, there's a really good video that we've just recently produced that I would like to roll now. Let's roll this video.
I'm Andrew McDonald. I'm a creative director and executive producer here at Cream in the digital department. It's very difficult to get a high fidelity, accurate looking character. We needed to find a simpler solution than that was available to model and animate a person and make them look like they're a person. And on top of all of that, have it optimized enough to be put into a mobile processor.
So Cream came to us and asked us if there was a better way to create digital doubles. And through research, we basically figured out this DDH system, which helps companies and helps people create characters super lightweight, cost-effective, and efficient. So DDH is Dynamic Digital Humans. It's a pipeline for creating characters efficiently. It's a system that thinks about the entire process and how studio can save on all the steps in the creation process.
With software like Faceware, you can now, using machine vision, pull the animation out of the face without having those tracking markers on the face. So you have the animation file from the face and you have clean video. And so we took the clean video and we baked it onto the animated model this time, and we got a result that was pretty impressive.
We were able to basically reproject the video that the Cartesian plane of the face was actually seeing, and we were able to unwrap that face and then reproject everything back onto the UVs and then lock it into the UVs, so that when you go into a game engine, you can now just throw a video texture onto your character.
So how are you finding this virtual reality thing?
It's fun, right?
What the DDH pipeline does is it allows artists to really not worry about things like technical limitations or knowledge limitations, and just sort of create without really heavy background in the technical mechanics behind character creating.
Creating characters is probably one of the most difficult tasks. There's a lot of steps in between that to make something look really believable. There's a lot of textures involved, a lot of time. So we actually did some research, and one of the software solutions that we were testing out was RealLusion. We developed our latest DDH system to include RealLusion into the pipeline. And by doing that, we're saving on skinning, we're saving on creating these bespoke characters, because now every character has the same joint names, has the same hair. So how do you go from a person to the actual model? So before, we were using a traditional, either an Esper rig or a rig system that you go into and do a photogrammetry set, you scan it, and now basically all the blend shapes we just get directly from Character Creator.
We wanted to see how well the DDH pipeline would translates singing performance into a face. So that's where we created Jasmine. Jasmine here is the first character that we created using a single structured light scan of a neutral pose. So that eliminated a whole piece of the pipeline of creating the traditional method of multiple scans and fitting them all together. And with Character Creator, we took that single scan and we were able to, using the projected video over the face, trace out all of those pose shapes and get them absolutely perfect right off of the Character Creator rig.
The idea of putting a video on top of a 3D model seems very easy. You could do it like, oh yeah, that's very cool, but in reality, there's a huge difference when it comes to PC and VR. For PC, it's not really an issue, but when you're trying to run it in Quest, imagine running a really powerful game on a phone, and you have to run it at 72 frames per second. You cannot run it at 60 frames per second or 30 frames per second like you would do with normal phone games, but we were able to do that at the end.
Great, okay, so that hopefully encapsulates what I was explaining at the very beginning. I guess the next things that we were gonna do on this webinar was talk about what we're doing with this. I guess one of the things I wanted to get across here is that our sort of MO in doing this entire project has always been try and find the least expensive, simplest way to do something. So, you know, what we've been sort of chipping away at with this entire pipeline over the past 4 years now is taking as many of the steps that we can and automating them. So, for example, what we spoke to earlier, how we've eliminated the need to go and do what the traditional pipeline of getting into a photogrammetry rig and capturing all those expressions and stuffing all those together into one blend shape. We're now, you know, have incorporated Character Creator, and we're able to sort of generate those blend shapes right from a single neutral scan. And now we're actually working on being able to do that with the LiDAR on an iPhone. So the whole point of this is to try and get it down into this sort of indie world that we exist in order to produce content with celebrities. So I think from there, what I had planned to do was talk about the entire process. So I'm a cameraman. My background is cinematography, and Stefan is mainly the tech lead on this project. So I think we've got these two parts we can divide it into. So there's a few things that I wanted to demonstrate, at least with shooting this, that are kind of critical, and we learned the hard way. So if anyone is interested in taking on this this project, all right. So what we realized in shooting this is we're using the helmet mounted camera, the brilliantly designed helmet mounted camera that Facewear has, which is a dream to work with.
I think these demos are with the Mark IV, the Mark IV headcam that you're using.
Or with the 4.3 lens. So what we're doing is we're kind of using it for a purpose it wasn't really designed for. It's the way it's built, and it's designed to capture the face and then extrapolate that motion data out of it. It's not that critical to see distortion isn't that important for the traditional Facewear process, but for us, because we're reprojecting the video back onto the three-dimensional model, it is quite important that you get as little distortion in the image as possible. So in this demonstration, I'm showing how even this 4.3 lens, which is very low distortion, there is still a slight amount of distortion, especially around the edges of the frame. But we've discovered that this sort of center area right here in the lens has very minimal distortion. And the second point is that the closer the lens is to the face, the further an angle it's looking down and up at the face, specifically to the eyes and the mouth. So if the lens is quite close to the face, it's kind of looking down at the mouth, which causes just a parallax almost distortion, like a point of view distortion on the mouth. So what we realized is that the face needs to be within this sort of target area, all the important features, the eyes and the mouth, all within that important area. So here's another example. Am I still sharing my screen?
Yeah.
Okay, so here's another example of a lot of the tests we went through. So this with Dominic Monaghan here, was a failure. It was a big nightmare to get this one working because we were far too close to the face. And then with Jasmine here, where we got some of the best results, we were out 10 inches, 9 to 10 inches from the face, with the dot being the very center of the lens, sort of right centered in the nose, which gets you enough of a distance away from the face that you've got all of the things sort of on the same axis line looking at the face. And then it's also important, if you see down here, not to, you know, have the helmet slide a little bit. It's a helmet position and camera position becomes quite critical with our process. And then the other thing I wanted to bring up is we've been playing around with all sorts of different lighting techniques, because again, it's very important to try and capture because you're using that video, you want that video to be to come without any baked in lighting. So you don't need any, you have to have all the lights off in your room to avoid throwing shadows on the face.
And make what we're as possible.
Pardon me?
Make everything as even as possible.
Yeah, as flat and as even as possible. So we're using a ring light here. And then on our last shoot, we came up with this sort of crazy horse blinder technique here, which is actually bouncing some of the ring light back into the sides of the face. So again, all we're really using is from, you know, we're capturing the wrinkles in the forehead, we're capturing the eyes, and we're capturing the mouth. So it's just that area that you need to concentrate on being as flat as possible. And what doesn't hurt, especially in warmer climates, is someone on set with some powder, because then you can, if you can take the shine off the face, then you get as matte, flat a face as humanly possible. So, and with that, I think what I'm going to do is hand it over to Stefan here, who can take us through the rest of the pipeline once you've captured a clean performance here. So attendees, go Stefan, control click, make presenter. There you go. It's all you, Stefan.
Great, thanks, Andrew. Okay, so this is basically a walkthrough to like really what is DDH, and really what it is a collection of tools and plugins that allow a team or a studio to actually create digital doubles really quickly. It's really easy to adapt and put into your own pipelines as well. But I also wanted to start out by just talking a little bit about CERT and how we got kind of connected with Andrew. And just because like this project and a lot of the projects we worked with other studios it takes a multidisciplinary collection of skills from around the industry to actually make something like this happen. In the end, it's an easy tool and it appears to be easy, but there's a lot of resources from a bunch of different teams. So the teams of expertise include like computer graphics, everything from character pipelines, design, creation, animation to rendering. We have software development involved from system architecture to programming, virtual production, including digital cinema, real-time rendering, motion capture, and AR walls. CERT also is now involved in artificial intelligence, and we're on to machine learning through like algorithms and applied data structures. My team's focus was around innovation in CG animation VFX and primarily character interactions and engagement to encourage believability and gain audience empathy. So we got our funding, like Andrew was saying, from federal and provincial funding in Canada. And it's great because it helps us develop these tools and work with partners in creating advances in the industry analyze and use tools that are currently in production or not available to the industry and partner with and develop relationships with companies to use in systems like DDH. So the Dynamic Digital Humans originated out of the collective research grants focused on integrating human and virtual human social interactions with a multi-platform user experience in extended reality. So extended realities was our focus, and we needed to make our characters as efficient as possible. And like Andrew said, they came to us with an initial question, is there a better way to create digital doubles? And really the solution that we came up with was DDH. And so basically it's a set of plugins and tools for production pipeline that can be easily adopted and integrated to rapidly create digital doubles that showcase full facial and body animations for VR. And so I'm just going to run through the general, like a high level overview of the pipeline.
I want to add to that just for a sec. The question of better way to create digital doubles, like ours is a way to create digital doubles that's accessible. I mean, there are $500,000 digital doubles that are spectacular. That is not in the realm of what we can do. So we were looking for that kind of better way.
For sure. For sure. And everyone knows when you're going into VR, especially when you're going into mobile applications, you really have to be efficient about what the process is. And essentially that's why we developed this whole pipeline with Cream to make it easy for other people that are going to have the same experience and to give people a takeaway from using and integrating these tools into their own pipelines. So I'm going to start with kind of just talking about the digital, how the process actually starts. And it starts, obviously, Faceware is a key element into the entire pipeline. And we're starting here in Analyzer. And you can see we're using the full facial cheek and jaws representation. because we are exporting neutral frames and we're trying to export as much information as possible that we can get through an XML file in the end. So like everyone else going through creating or tracking models and stuff, we're using the Pro version or the Studio Plus version, which allows us to share poses and collectively add to a production and spend less time having to track performances because we can use pre-track data to add to these performances. Some novel things that Peter was kind of referencing in the beginning was we're using this XML data in particular ways, especially tracking the eye sections here that I'm highlighting. And we're paying if you pay attention to the facial movements in the way we're like Andrew was saying, we're reprojecting the image back on our characters' faces. We need to try and stabilize the actions of the character, especially if they're wearing motion capture suits and moving around. But with any head movement and facial movement, you get a jump in the video. And this is evident. This isn't evident when you're if you're just creating a standard character. But in the DDH process, since we're locking this to a 3D mesh, we're trying to stabilize the upper skull. And then through this video, you can see we're stabilizing. You can see the movement around the teeth, and so whenever the teeth move, we know that the skull is moving. So visual representations were through the teeth and the eye movement itself. So by capturing the XML data and the movement of the points of the face, we can use those later on in the process as tracking marks. The other thing I'm just kind of pointing out here is we're including the convenient burned-in tracking results as well. So if there are any errors in a pipeline, it's really a piece of information that is like necessary for when you're in a whole pipeline with multiple people. And then our next step is going into, we have a DDH template project inside of After Effects. So basically we start with this DDH image processor, which is an installer essentially that comes with the tool, and it merges third-party applications together, including After Effects, Maya, and Faceware. So anything that we need to combine and use tools together to create these images really quickly, it provides plugins and tools that are integrated into the software. So what you're looking at right now is the template for After Effects, and things that I just want to briefly point out is timing. So we're grabbing the footage from the Faceware extraction. So in this template, you can see that it's labeled, it's numbered from 0 to 10. And what I talked about before is grabbing that XML data for stabilization. Well, we're using it in this first step. And the stabilization essentially is a process, and through research, we've been figuring out all these steps and how to improve on performances and the speed of the whole process to try to automate every step along the way. So we created this inverse mean, we're calling inverse mean stabilization, which is the Procreates algorithm, which tries to resolve sliding movement on multiple points. And we're using the XML data here. You can see I'm just selecting it, and we're applying that XML data to, we're just loading it into the scene. And essentially it's a one-click solution. You click stabilize, and that footage is stabilized as well as you have tracked, or the track information that has been provided. And then we also, if there's a possibility that it's not stabilized enough, so you can go in and you can, with the After Effects tools that are available, you can do some traditional tracking using the traditional trackers that exist inside of After Effects to kind of stabilize on top of the stabilization as well. But these are like handy tools that just come with that DDH installer. It's in the tool set itself. I'm just going to skip forward to the next step, which is the copy stabilize to mouth. And here, this is the next three steps essentially are another automated section. And what we're attempting to do here is we're trying to correct for any projection information that is going to cause some false artifacts. So through research, we figured out what we could do is we could isolate the inner mouth using the landmark positions and create masks based on that. And so we developed with the programming team another tool that is in the DDH plugin section called Face Tracker. And essentially you can choose the landmark regions. And again, we're accessing the same XML data from the same shot, and it's another two-click point, and you get your tracking information. Now, typically everyone that has done rotoscoping and stuff knows how long a process like this can take, even with the automated tools. So we're always trying to look for solutions, and like that's why Faceware is really integral part of this whole process, because by using Faceware, you've taken something that could take you like a week to do to something that takes you a couple of seconds to do, which is great. The next step is an automated mouth masking, where Andrew in this video briefly talked about Reallusion and kind of the evolution of the characters that and where they evolved to. And we're using Reallusion in the DDH pipeline because we really like the topology of the characters, the UV layouts, the way the meshes are divided, and the ability to create some sort of standard application and procedural nature to creating our characters. We started out with bespoke models, and you don't need to only use one way of doing things. And that's a great thing about this DDH toolset is you can apply the same settings to any special layouts and stuff that you have created for your team and your pipeline, and it can just be easily adapted to work with your pipeline through a series of masks and mats. And so here you can see this next section is the content aware fill, and this is using the machine learning tools that are available in After Effects. This is research we did a year ago. And again, it's like a one-click solution that easily just replaces the teeth that were there. And you can see that the teeth no longer exist in the shot. The next step is going into the render head projection. So the interesting thing about this pipeline, and Andrew briefly talked about it before, was the fact that we're using the methods of the Disney legends that were rotoscoping animation, and we're referencing real life. And that's essentially what we're doing here, is we're using as much information, and we're trying to basically rotoscope animation on top of our characters. And so we're using the flat, and it's great because it's only a single camera that we're using.
Like an onion skin, being able to trace out and, yeah.
Exactly. And it is with a single front-facing camera, which is fantastic because you don't have to have multiple angles and shots. And we actually have developed a system that accounts for information on the side of the nose. And so that first render head projection was for the onion skinning part. The second render mouth fill is for the next steps when we get into Maya and the reprojection of the texture. So here we're just kind of demonstrating that here I'm just liquefying the nose, and this is the animation without the teeth movement. The teeth are not visible in this screenshot. So then we leave that process and we're heading into Maya. Now again, this is a demonstration or a demo sequence that we're providing with the release of the tools when they become available. And so in Maya, we're using Retargeter, obviously, with Faceware, and is another necessary, we believe, step just to make things happen very quickly. And here you can see I'm showing the projection, and there's a series of tools that have been written for materials and how we combine those materials. And you basically just provide your Faceware camera projection that has been cooked out inside of After Effects, apply it over top of your mesh, and here I'm showing the masks that are involved in masking out. So what is white is UV information, and what is black is going to be projection. And that can be changed with just by changing the mask. And if you wanted to add more cameras, you can add more cameras by just adding some new masks in there as well. And then I'm just scrubbing through the animation, and I'm just going to kind of skip through this. I wanted to kind of showcase that. So the great thing about this onion skinning process is we are basically using the mesh, and we can see any errors in the mesh by just scrubbing through the video and using the blend shapes. And the great thing about this Laura character as well is there are no extra rigs that have been added, or any type of skeletal information that is different from what's offered from Reallusion. Here is the.
I want to add, Stefan. What's really cool about this is that a very junior person can now retarget and clean up animation, which is what we've sort of been running at our shop.
Exactly. Yes. This is the demonstration of the DDH tools. You can see DDH image processor tools inside of Maya, and it's really just a system that allows you to bake out per frame every single frame, and it also creates the extra meshes or the extra textures like normal maps and height maps and specular maps depending on what you want to use in your VR layouts. Here I'm demonstrating that we're again using the Retargeter Plus versions, and we're using shared poses as much as possible. And in our pipeline and when you're working on stuff, it's really important that if you're working with a big team, that you label things correctly and that you can reuse these poses. So in the beginning, you may have 20 shapes that you're keying, while at the end, you may have only two keyframes that you have to put in because you're basically using those previous shared poses. And then here in the channel box, you can see that those are the original blend shapes. No extra blend shapes have been made to actually lock on to this character's performance. And that's really exciting too, because before we were using bespoke created rigs and custom rigs that you no longer really, they're not really that necessary. And then once you have all the data locked in there, you can easily reproduce this for a whole host of characters that are coming from your procedural pipelines. So once we've finished in Maya and we've retargeted our animations, we're happy with the animations, we come back and now we are in the compositing section of the After Effects template. And I'm just kind of showing you, this is like the mouth normal that we get. It has crisp edges, and all we're doing here is we're smoothing those edges out. The specular map, we're changing intensities to intensities that apply inside of Unity and in VR. And here you can see, this is the Atlas. So this is really the step that's important for getting character animation in VR. And you can see the combined projection and UV map. And here I'm demonstrating that we have two versions in this template, and one is to use a large head as our diffuse model, and the other is to use a large normal as our other model. And I prefer, and we recommend, we have documentation and recommendations for the pipeline, but I prefer using the normal map as the bigger map to use for inside of VR, especially because it provides the lighting information that is necessary for when you're up there really close and looking at your character's pores, which, you know, in VR we tend to like to watch exactly what our characters are saying, and so that provides extra detail for those maps. And then the last thing I was mentioning here is we tend to do a reference render, and this render is to test out the texture quality. And this demonstrates the quality of the textures that are coming out of the DDH image processor. And we can also see if there's any faults in the animation. So you can see there's like some lip intersection. And so obviously you can go back and you can correct those intersections and correct the animations as well. And then, so now we are inside of the DDH tool inside of Unity, and this is the last step of going from Unity to VR or Unity to whatever application, and also you can go from Unreal if you prefer to use Unreal into desktop builds as well.
this is Unity URP optimized for Quest. You can also do HDRP and get it to what we were just showing out of Maya.
Exactly. But yeah, you're totally right. This is demonstrating what's coming out in for VR. So you want, working to optimize on a mobile processor, you need to, there's a lot of limitations. And in this demo, we're demonstrating one light. So this is character is lit with one light and the textures that are coming out of that atlas. So it's the skin qualities and the textures that are, the materials that are coming out of here is a custom DDH shader that was created inside of Unity. And I'm just demonstrating the character's performance. And we have a tool that basically connects the, so this tool connects the animations playback with the animations of the character's movements and combines them together so they run and play in sync. And it does, there's a lot of other things it does under the hood as well. The tool comes with this importing, so you can import your model. You can import a folder that has a collection of models on it. And after you've done, so, and really this is a reviewing tool so that you can review your animations in VR. So you can see there's buttons on the side of the window there. And those buttons allow you to skip through animations and stuff if you're in your headset, so that you can get close to your character and see if there are any errors with your animations. And then you can feedback your animations back into this tool relatively quickly. And here I'm also showing the layout for the DDH head, the atlas. So we have a bunch of functions here where you can choose the atlas layout, like large, normal, or large diffuse, like I was mentioning before. And here I'm also talking a little bit about the linear color space versus RGB color space. And it works really well with the linear processing of the video footage. And then we have the ability to, if you don't want to go in the headset because it's too distracting to get in and out, you can basically just use the UI menu and just play back your animations by skipping through animations and freezing animations at certain points. And it really is a perfect way to review your characters once you're in VR. And again, one lighting and all the textures are automatically set to where they belong. So I'm just going to, I think that's where I kind of, that's the entire process. So you can see it's pretty easy to go through. And I'm going to just show a video. So I'm just going to stop showing application. And I'm going to go into, so here is the reference video of the droids animation.
Your droids? They'll have to wait outside. We don't serve their kind here. Kidding! I've just always wanted to say that.
And again, that's just to test the quality of the textures that are in the that are coming out of the pipeline. And the next one I was going to show is the Laura droid's performance in VR. So that's an example of the performance.
Your droids? They'll have to wait outside. We don't serve their kind here. Kidding! I've just always wanted to say that. Your droids? They'll have to wait outside. We don't serve their kind here. Kidding! I've just always wanted to say that. Impressive police work, Sheriff. Hey. You want to grab a drink sometime after my shift's over? Just kidding. My shift's never over. Plus, I'm pretty sure I'll self-destruct if I leave the station.
So, and then the last one, I also have the Jasmine performance in here if you wanted to show that as well, Andrew.
Sure.
I'm gonna play that one through. So again,
Don't play the whole thing. Just play like 30, 40 seconds.
Sure. That last performance was the screen grab from Maya that you first saw. Then you saw in basically in Unity, and that would be the direct VR demonstration of what that character's animations look like. And then
I would add it's interesting too, because showing those demos, we're also showing like some of the, you know, the flaws in our process, which is that what we've done is we've taken the video projection of the face, transferring all that detail, the wrinkles, all those things, including the interior mouth, which enables us to get these, I feel, very really good looking sync speech shots out of it, because you're seeing the tongue bouncing around inside the mouth and accurately and in sync with actual speech. But again, it's just a projection of the interior mouth in 2D inside the mouth. So when you do go on the side of it and really up close, you can kind of see that it's just a projection of the mouth in the inside. But again, when you're in a VR headset and you're playing some of these experiences, or even in AR, because we're using this for AR as well on mobile phone, you don't really do that. No one's like this when they're looking at somebody, right? So it kind of holds up.
Yeah. And again, we could provide limitations on how far someone actually could come into a character's reach. But here, I'm going to show the Jasmine one, and then we can open up to questions. But here is the Jasmine animation.
When you're broken down and tired of living life on a merry-go-round, and you can't find the fighter, but I see it in you, so we gonna walk it out.
So yeah, there's a little clip of that. And that again just demonstrates to like a fully path traced version of the character and to the quality of the textures coming out that are being used in Arnold as a render. But these same textures are the ones that we're using inside the other renders. And due to limitations of those renderers, we have to develop it in a certain way for sure.
And that shows that you can render a higher end version of that and use it for applications like virtual production, like put it in Unreal and shoot a movie kind of thing.
Yeah. Yeah. And so that's pretty much the workflow of the DDH tools. And again, it's an easy system to apply to anything, any pipeline that's out there. And that's really all to say about that.
Fantastic, guys. So I want to encourage everybody that everything that we just walked through, we have the question box. So go ahead and ask some questions. There's some already that are coming in throughout what you guys presented. So I want to dive straight into those. But in short, you know, one of the best parts of my job is you guys, right? And what you're trying to do and out of this out of the box thinking. We've all seen lots of this sort of movement that's going on in avatar character creation tools. You know, we've always positioned our company in how do you move these characters, right? How do you bring that believability to performance and animation? Because we all know this is sort of a very complicated recipe, and we represent one of those ingredients. And one of the things, again, that's exciting, I see this sort of as a starting point, even though obviously a considerable amount of effort has gone into what you guys have presented here. But the fact that you want to make this externally available, I mean, we all know how many tech demos that come out that you might be impressed, but then there's no accessibility. And I'm glad, Andrew, that you touched on that the part that you guys really want to lean in on was that accessibility and that innovation through necessity. So let's get into questions. There's a couple that had the same question. Let's go, Gus Beaudry here. What is the total turnaround time from capture to animation for a project like Jasmine? Alton Glass also has a similar question.
Oh, wow, that's a good question. It's interesting because Jasmine was like the first one we were like, okay, we're gonna try this with one neutral scan. So everything we've been doing so far sits in the R&D realm, and R&D, I mean, Stefan's working on five other projects at the same time, as well as the university. So it's hard to gauge is the answer. But I would say right now, because we're now getting down to being able to produce about 3 or 4 minutes of performance in about a day and a half. Like, so that's that entire song, we could track it, clean it up, bake it into the character, and have that all that labor done of making the animation in about a day and a half. Now, scanning it, cleaning up the scan, and getting it through the character creator pipeline, I would safely give someone 3 weeks to do it. So I'm just spitballing right now, but I would say I'd say a month, and I would quote it as a month and a half.
But you got to also remember too, like this is an exponential process, right? So what you do in the beginning gets a lot faster as you work this through at the end, especially because we're reusing all the resources. So if it's the first time you've done this, then yes, it would take longer. If this is the second model that you've done, and this is a part of a pipeline that you're setting up, then it's exponential how quick, how fast you can recreate these systems. And also it's about how you divide your performances, because if you have a long performance that is referencing a ROM performance of your character's movements in the beginning, that one ROM performance can drive the rest of your performances pretty quickly. So getting the initial tracking and retargeting side of things done is, yeah, that's why we love Faceware, is because it's super quick, especially if you're in the Plus studio. And then once you're in the DDH tool set, it's a matter of like clicking and just continue clicking because the templates are set up to work as compositing tool sets. So it's a chain where the first composites, all the series of sequences that follow that just reference that first composite. Yeah,
and I appreciate you speaking to the scalability factor, right? Again, if we're trying to create a volume of believability, I think this is what you guys are tapping into. So another question from Greg Stewart here. What files do you guys end up with at the end of the process that would be need to pass into a game engine or a renderer?
Yeah, so I mean, in the end, the files are an FBX for animation. And I was briefly just talking about the DDH Unity tool, where it provides an exporter that basically collects all of your FBX animations. You create a character rigging file that has your skeletal data and your skinning weights and all the textures that are associated with that, and you also have your Atlas videos that are there, and they're just MP4 videos that are highly compressed. And that's the other thing about this process that is amazing, is these videos, like the Jasmine performance, I think is like a 10 megabit file, which is like super small. And so when you're running that with a piece of animation that's like another 10 megabytes as well, these are super small files that can be added to character profiles that are going through with your character. And so they're just FBX and video files, essentially.
Okay, awesome, thank you. Yeah, so a couple other combined questions here. Got Alton Glass and Cooper O'Neill. So could you summarize what software and hardware you would need to try this out, as well as the roles that you guys used in terms of your staff from capture to animation, like what kind of skills they need to sort of pull all this together?
Sure, I can start with the front side of it. So you would need a fantastic Faceware helmet camera with their 4.3 millimeter lens. So whether or not you can beg, borrow, steal, or buy one, because they're not that expensive. So that's a good start. Then you would need a quiet space to shoot it in, nothing too fancy. You don't need a giant soundstage. You'd need a ring light, and you'd need a couple pieces of foam core, and a camera guy who knows what they're doing, so they're recording the right formats and everything. And that will produce your facial performance. For scanning your subject, the last one we did, Jasmine, we did with the Peel scanner. We have yet to prove the pipeline with an iPhone 13, but I'm pretty confident we can achieve almost exactly the same results with an iPhone 13 and a proper scan. So just make sure your model, I find if you have something at the back of the head that the model can lean their head against so that they're not moving at all, and you go around as quickly as you can and get that base scan. And again, that's just the same size studio. And then you need a subject, and you know, small producer and some snacks and stuff like that. So, and that's all of your physical capture stuff, and then it all goes over to Stefan.
Yeah, and then on the post-production side of things, it's essentially, yeah, you need a character artist to take that head and put it on a mesh. But great, like I said, we're instead of creating bespoke models with custom rigs and stuff, we just adopted using Reolusion, which is like you're just attaching the body to the mesh. In our team, really, we were making a prototype. Like what you're seeing there is a prototype. They're all prototypes right now. Cream is actually in the process of making production models now and doing the whole production. But you can see the prototype is actually pretty great. And again, like Andrew's saying, this is a one research project of like 10 that I was working on all at the same time. So it's a matter of...
You need a machine with like a 2080 or a 3080 GPU. You'd need like
not even no. Yeah, sure. If you want to go high end, yeah, for sure. But yeah, the faster you can process things, the better. You need After Effects, Maya, Faceware, and let's add Reolusion into that pipeline as well. Those are the four components, and then the DDH tool just kind of adds all of the, it networks everything together essentially. And then obviously Photoshop. So if you get the Photoshop suite, it's great there too.
Awesome.
But yeah.
A very specific question from Jeremy Fox. What about the tongue?
Well, that's what I was speaking to earlier. So what we've done is we've completely avoided the mouth bag altogether. So there is no mouth bag, no teeth, no animated tongue in any of these characters. So the tongues that you're seeing, specifically the Jasmine character singing at you, and you see that really highly accurate tongue. As I mentioned earlier, if you were to sit right here, super close up and look at it sideways, you would see that it's like a kabuki. It's like a screen inside the mouth with the two-dimensional performance of that mouth projected in that screen. So you'll see it from the side and they're like, oh, that's strange. But from pretty much every angle straight on and at this distance, it's very good lip sync. So yeah, no tongue.
Yeah, I forgot to mention that piece, there is a piece of geometry that's in the mouth that is like a screen that has the normal map light bending on it. So it kind of looks like the tongue is moving around inside the mouth. But yeah, it's really just a screen that's accepting the projection during the creation of the textures.
And actually, we got a plan for actually adding depth to that video. You could make that video technically with ML, you can make that have depth, like volumetric video.
Yeah.
All right, guys, we got about 5 minutes, a few more questions. Gus Beaudry, super follow-up question. Have you run multiple characters in VR in an Unreal scene? How many do you think you could reasonably support on screen at once?
Yes, that was one of the research projects that we did. And so the limitation inside of a mobile processor is how many video feeds that you can have decoding and encoding at the same time. So I think that research took place like 3 years ago before everything got better. So that was using the Oculus One. And I think we had 7 models playing at the same time. So obviously the better the hardware, the more encoding, decoding you can get, and it's basically due to the size of the resolution of the screen itself that the Atlas is rendered on.
Yeah, it all comes down to other factors too. Like I think we could get 7, but we could get like 24 running if they didn't have any hair. You know, so it's like, so there's so many other things that go into characters that are gonna chew up bandwidth. So
yeah, and actually the demo scene that you're going to be given access to actually has Laura as a model, where She has been optimized in a way that, at least inside of Unity, it's very efficient, and you can see the frame rates that they're like running off the charts. There's no hits to any limitations at all, so it's great.
Gotcha. And you tapped into Alton. Just asked a question: will the demo asset be able to load it in Unreal and Unity and looked at in VR when you guys sort of release everything?
Yes, we do have a version for Unreal, and we do have a version for Unity. The VR route, though, is going through Unity, obviously. But I mean, now that Unreal is jumping on and adding more support for VR and stuff, that I'm sure it can be adapted to handle that as well. But there are demos for VR, and there are demos for desktop applications. So you can use the HDR pipeline or the standard textures coming in Unreal as well. I think our early model with Don Monahan had like full hair groom on him, like a simple hair groom. So he had perfect hair strands, and we were running all that as well. So yeah.
Gotcha. And so last question here from Brandon Sullivan: how much will this cost? I know. Say what you guys can. I know the release is still a month or so away or whatnot.
We're
just give people an indication, right? I know we're tapping into accessibility.
Yeah, we're still working out pricing models. Like, there's a lot to consider, especially when it comes to support. So the answer is we don't know. But if you are interested in this and you do want to take it for a trial run, we are really keen to take some select few and just here you go. Take it and run with it and see what you can produce. And another thought we had was to get some kind of a challenge going to see how many others could make a decent character and what they could do with it. So that's to come. We'll have a lot more information.
Yeah, that's a great segue. I mean, I think the biggest actionable thing here is for people that are interested and want to try this out, go ahead and contact the DDH guys right now. They're looking for testers. And then when this releases later this summer, one thing I'm paying attention to is how this is going to be used and pushed and innovated in the future, right? It's a fantastic framework, a different approach. That's what's interesting and exciting. And really appreciate your guys' time. Appreciate everybody that attended today. Again, we're recording this. We'll be sharing that out through all of our channels. You guys can check the chat box for all of the helpful links. And everybody enjoy the rest of your day.
Thanks, Peter.
Thanks, Peter.